only on the Discovery Channel.
It's those incredible animals and those incredible birds of prey. This time I'll show you how falcons are making a big comeback in the big city. Then we'll meet a doctor whose most important patients are birds of prey.
Most of the birds are hurt by man.
And the birthday of a baby California condor.
Hello, I'm Loretta Swett, and welcome to Those Incredible Animals. For years, falcons dominated the skies, but pesticides and America's changing landscape have made these birds practically extinct. Nowadays, thanks to a hardworking group of conservationists, these wild birds are finding a new home in the city. He's perhaps the fastest bird on earth. He'll hit 200 miles an hour while diving at his prey. Throughout history, he's been the stuff of Egyptian legend and European sport. But in this country just a decade ago, he was all but wiped out by the pesticide DDT. And yet, the peregrine falcon is making a comeback.
A daring experiment is underway to have peregrines live and breed atop Los Angeles skyscrapers. From those heights, they will find plenty of prey, no natural predator, and perhaps a chance to step back from the edge of extinction.
They capture their prey by flying very high and then coming down very fast at speeds.
At speeds
exceeding 200 miles an hour.
Wow.
Brian Walton and his colleagues from the Santa Cruz Predatory Bird Research Group are helping this beautiful bird survive in California, where just a few years ago there were only two left. The culprit is DDT, which poisoned the peregrine's food chain.
And as the amount of DDT increases in their body, it causes them to lay thin eggshells. Mm-hmm. And when they lay thin eggshells, they accidentally break them during incubation. And that means that they have fewer and fewer young every year, and eventually there's no young to come back to breed, and the population goes down.
But Brian's group has found a daring answer to the problem of the fragile eggs. They replace them with young falcons they have hatched themselves.
So what we do is we go out to the wild nests, and we bring those eggs into captivity and hatch them in an incubator where there are no adults to accidentally break them.
Those wild nests are in high places, like the cliffs of El Capitan in Yosemite National Park. So to reach the eggs, the scientists have become mountain climbers. Once at the nest, they swap newborn falcon chicks for the defective eggs, and happily, the peregrine parents don't realize they've been had.
Without exception, every single time we've attempted this, which is hundreds of times now, the adult peregrines have accepted the young that we put in the nest. They don't seem to realize that they aren't their eggs or their young. They are stimulated by the presence, and they immediately accept the young and start brooding them, and then the male goes out and gets food.
The thin-shelled eggs are carried back to Santa Cruz, where they are incubated with tender, loving care. This is the new peregrine generation. The hopes for the future rest on their young wings. But to escape the DDT poison, a new place must be found for them to live. You'd think that a city would be a strange home for the peregrine, but places like Washington and New York have proven that the falcons can live atop high buildings and eat city birds such as pigeons and starlings, which are free of DDT. And now, Los Angeles is host to several pairs of peregrines.
The original releases in this area were way down Wilshire Boulevard in Westwood, just where the horizon is now.
Mm-hmm.
And some of those birds have taken up residence in Century City and near the La Brea Tar Pits. And there's a pair breeding now on the bank building here in downtown Los Angeles.
From an office building in the Arco Tower, Brian showed me the spot on the Union Bank building across the street where the peregrines first laid eggs. Unfortunately, the eggs were thin-shelled. So Brian and others bravely crawled out on a 3-foot ledge some 38 stories above Wilshire Boulevard and switched 10-day-old chicks for the eggs. The resident falcons and their adopted young are common sights downtown now. Newspaper contests have even named the birds. But in spite of the publicity,
Just helping the Falcons get back on their feet is reward enough for Brian.
All of us that are involved in the program are very pleased. It's doubly rewarding to the people at the Bird Group because a lot of the birds that we've hatched and raised at our facility in Santa Cruz are actually breeding in the wild now. But the population still has increased from 2 pairs to 60 pairs, but there used to be hundreds of pairs, so we're not completely out of the problem area yet. But things are looking very promising, yes.
Efforts to save the falcon have been a success. However, some New Yorkers aren't so thrilled with their resident birds of prey. Seems that the number of pigeons in the city is declining at an alarming rate. It's hard to believe, but the New Yorkers are afraid the pigeons might wind up on an endangered list. Joining me now is Lori Collard, and this is Tetra, a peregrine falcon.
Right.
And she is, how old did you say?
Tetra's 3 years old.
Oh, what does that mean? And will you tell us a little bit about this equipment, the hood she's wearing and the little bell here? And
well, Tetra's wearing some basic falconry equipment. It's the hood she's wearing is an aid in training. It helps keep her very calm. As you can see, she's real calm sitting on your fist.
She is.
Also, it basically what she can't see won't hurt her.
And she won't hurt it.
That's correct.
Or me, I should say.
Also, when the hood is removed, that's sort of her cue that it's time to fly, time to go hunting.
And have
fun. So it acts as a training aid. Right.
Yes,
right.
She must be very happy doing that.
She loves to fly. This other equipment that we have on her, she's got a bell on, and that's so that when she is flying, we can locate her. If we can't always see her right away, we can hear her coming. This other piece of equipment here is a radio telemetry, and that's so that if she does fly off, we can find her with a transmitter, and we can track her.
She's beautiful. She's just beautiful. Is she your favorite?
I have to admit, yes, she's one of my favorites, right? Yes.
Did you hear that? Thank you so much,
You're
Lori.
Welcome.
Thank you, Tetra. Next on Those Incredible Animals, a winter wonderland for America's national symbol, the bald eagle.
They fly circles around each other. And then they lock talons in the air. It's just great. Made in the air, they say.
This portion of Discovery is brought to you in part by Fancy Feast Gourmet Cat Food.
When a new creation comes from Carolina Herrera, you know it will be classic. When a new design comes from Vacheron Constantine, you know it will be timeless. And when a new dry cat food comes from Fancy Feast, you know it will be extraordinary. Introducing new Fancy Feast Gourmet Dry. So supremely delicious. So exquisitely satisfying. It could only come from Fancy Feast. New Fancy Feast Gourmet Dry cat food. Good taste is easy to recognize.
New Clorox Toilet Cleanser has bleach and abrasives to help make stains disappear.
Now, be honest, have you ever had a cat box odor problem?
No, never.
What? You need Fresh Step cat litter, ma'am. It releases fresheners every time your cat steps. Only Fresh Step freshens with every step.
Ancient myths, forbidden fortunes, tales of crusades and conquests, riches lost through the ages, and mysteries that puzzle us all. Journey to fascinating places. Uncover treasure of legend and lore, the bizarre and the amazing, the adventure and the excitement. Terra X, followed by the Treasure Hunters. Tuesday, beginning at 8 Eastern, 7 Central, only on the Discovery Channel.
The bald eagle has been America's symbol since 1782. Surprisingly, very few of us have ever seen one in the wild. One place you can still see them in their nesting grounds is near the Skagit River in Washington State.
Winter, some 12,000 American bald eagles leave Alaska and Canada and fly south to the warmer climate of the lower 48 states. More than 500 of these birds will spend their three-month vacation here on the Skagit River in Washington State. For America's national symbol, this is Disneyland. They can perch on a limb and literally wait for a salmon dinner to drift by.
Well, here on the Skagit, the eagles have it pretty easy in the wintertime. They don't usually fly much unless it's useful flight, meaning that they have to use their body fat that they get from eating all these salmon to stay warm, so they can't be wasting it with goofing off or fooling around.
Libby Mills is a writer, a wildlife photographer, and an artist.
I can watch eagles right from this window any time of the year, so I wanted to draw a picture of eagles that showed all their needs together, both the dead trees that they like, the forest, and the fish that they depend on.
Dabbling in the arts is only a sideline for Libby. Her full-time job carries the lofty title of Skagit River Bald Eagle Preserve Steward. She works for the Nature Conservancy. It's a private organization that prevents natural habitats from being developed by buying up the property. Once a week, Libby gathers up her telescope and clipboard to count the birds that roost in the 1,500-acre preserve.
Threat to eagles right now is loss of habitat, that their nesting trees along the coast are still being logged off, and that the food supply, the fish that they need, are still being over-harvested.
Even though eagles mate for life, they often take separate vacations, then meet again in the spring.
We only have about 130 to 150 nesting pairs in Washington State. So the great part of the population here, about 1,100 wintering eagles in Washington, will head back north again. And there they go through a spectacular courtship. They fly circles around each other, and then they lock talons in the air. It's just great. And made in the air, they say.
A young eagle leaves the nest as soon as he can fly, but his head won't turn white until he's 5 or 6 years old. The biggest problem for any bird, of course, is food. And this is where the white heads of the adult birds come in handy. A youngster in search of food need only cruise the river until he spots the white-headed adults on the ground.
And that white head is like a light bulb turned on. It says this is where the food is. So they just look for other eagles with white heads.
It takes a lot of food to keep these 10-pound birds going, and they quickly take advantage of someone else's dinner. Of course, that's the very reason Ben Franklin, some 200 years ago, voted for the wild turkey as the nation's symbol instead of the eagle.
The bald eagle, he said, is a scavenger. It will steal food from other eagles. It's an opportunist. It takes the opportunity and takes advantage of it. He thought that wasn't a very good national symbol.
The salmon run also signals the end of vacation. 3 months of sitting and eating is over. Now it's back to the old grind in Alaska, hunting, fishing, and sitting in a tree with a mate. Maybe even thinking about next year's vacation.
Now, one man who's seen a lot of eagles is Philip Schultz. He's a former surgeon who now specializes in a different kind of patient, a former hunter turned bird lover. You might call him the bird doctor.
We humans have long been fascinated by these graceful and lethal flyers, even training them to tag along with us in the sky. But we are also the reason these birds for many years were in trouble. Man so severely polluted the bird's habitat, or took it entirely away, that some species became extinct. Today, raptors are making a small comeback, principally because we have started to clean up the environment and given the birds a healthier place to live. But part of the credit must also go to a hard-working network of people across the country known as the rehabilitators.
Although they're not malicious animals at all, they're just terribly powerful, very, very strong.
Over the years, Dr. Philip Schultz has nursed back to health dozens of injured birds of prey at his home in Santa Fe, New Mexico.
That's the typical kestrel call.
Does that mean anything? That
yes,
that
means that eagle scares the hell out of him.
Former hunter, surgeon, and skilled amateur photographer, Schultz is one of the hundreds of Americans who have, out of love and respect for nature, struggled to save animals hurt by man. It is work rehabilitators love to do, but wouldn't need to do if we were only more careful or less cruel.
Most of the birds are hurt by man. Now, gunshots probably represent about 35% of the ones we get. Then steel trap injuries, hit by cars when they're feeding on roadkill rabbits along roadsides, and poisonings make up about 80% total, including the gunshots. So over 80% of the birds that we get are due to man's depredation in one shape or form. And this bird was shot in the leg, probably with a .22 hollow point, and the bone is healed. But the bird had tendon damage to the feet also, and doesn't have a normal foot. But it's about ready to be released now. This bird, it was completely quadriplegic. It was obviously a poisoning. I put the bird in a sling to hold it up out of its own droppings, and we hand-fed it for a couple of weeks until it began to regain some of the use of its wings first, and took it out, and it would pull itself around on the ground with its wings, just like they were front feet, dragging its legs, and then it gradually got function of its legs back. We still don't know what the poison was.
Schultz has been a privateer working in his own backyard. Other rehabilitation operations, such as the one at Seattle's Woodland Park Zoo, are a little bigger. Senior birdkeeper Deborah Stetcher has helped return 60 eagles back into the wild.
Some birds can't be returned. Some birds, many birds die. Those that don't are put in educational programs or breeding programs. And those birds also help later on with their offspring going back into the wild.
And perhaps the best-known rehab center of them all is the Raptor Center at the University of Minnesota, St. Paul. The staff at the center has saved thousands of birds of prey over the years and pioneered critical field and laboratory studies on the birds. Although veterinarians are often needed to save a wounded bird of prey, they make up only 10 to 15% of rehabilitators. Dr. Sean Ogburn in Austin, Texas, is one of those vets, donating hours of his time and skill every month. His patient on this day is a ferruginous hawk named Harry, who had been crippled by a gunshot wound. You need a lot of love, skill, and patience, and a license or permit to be a rehabilitator. And saving individual animals will not by itself save the bird. But Philip Schultz, Deborah Stetcher, and Sean Ogburn say it still feels great to get every bird they can back where it belongs.
The first thing is you worry about, you know, well, this bird going to get shot, hit by a car, what's going to be the ultimate end of the bird? But the joy of seeing a bird go free after you've worked with them, it's just counteracts all that. The most exciting part is seeing birds that you've released months later, or I had one come by about a year later, fly over the house and recognize the bird. And it was exhilarating because I knew it was a success. You know, the bird was back and healthy and in the wild doing what it should do.
Coming up next on Those Incredible Animals, a baby condor celebrates its birthday.
For literacy. Learning to read should be simple. Phonics makes reading simple by teaching little sounds and syllables. I learned to read with Phonics.
Learn to read with Hooked on Phonics, the musical reading program. Then, read to learn with SRA reading comprehension used by over 60 million people.
Hooked on Phonics works for me.
Call 1-800-ABCDEFG.
New Clorox Automatic.
It's like cleaning your toilet with Clorox bleach every time you flush.
Do you have a problem with cat box odor?
No, I don't.
Huh?
Well, evidently you need Scoop Fresh scoopable litter from Fresh Step. It freshens even when you're not scooping. Yeah, why just scoop when you can scoop fresh?
You wish you could hear someone help you refocus your ways and plan your future? Beginning in January, you can find inspiration and hope through the practical teachings of Pastor Jack Hayford each Sunday morning at 11 o'clock right here on your cable system, Channel 6. Now you can join with the thousands who share each week in the worship services of the Church on the Way in Van Nuys. Plan now to watch Dr. Jack Hayford's Living Way television program each Sunday morning at 11 o'clock on cable Channel 6. Beginning in January, your Sundays won't be the same.
Hey, Dave, we better hurry and get over to the field. Whoa, where'd you get the cool place? Barcelona?
No, I ordered it from the DMV, and the proceeds go to help support the Olympic Training Center being built here in California.
Well, I'm all for the U.S. Olympic Training Center. How do I get one?
Make your car an Olympic star. Stop by any DMV or auto club office and order your plates today.
Well, that was easy.
California condor is one of the world's most endangered birds of prey. Once they were everywhere. Today there are only a handful left. And so, bird conservationists are trying to give the condor a helping hand. They're becoming bird moms.
This star made his debut on national television. The historic occasion was the first hatching of a California condor egg in captivity. This little bald-headed ambassador gave most of us our first close-up look at a bird that's been around for nearly 3 million years. And to the dozens of people working on the project, this quack meant more than just advancing the cause of science and biology. He meant that their efforts might not be in vain, that the California condor just might survive. Biologist Bill Toon has been involved with the project for several years.
One of the questions I hate the most and that I get actually very frequently is, why do we save such an ugly bird? And I think the point is that we don't save species based on what they look like or how much they contribute to mankind. That's a pretty self-centered view of the world. And I think all it takes is seeing one and there can be a great deal of emotion tied up in it.
But now the condor is disappearing just as fast as the California wilderness, and biologists have to try a daring plan. Eggs would be snatched from condor nets to fool the parents into laying another. It was the only way to start a captive population and not threaten wild condors, and that meant scaling cliffs to find hidden nests. Next stop, the San Diego Zoo. A waiting team of specialists had practiced for weeks with chicken eggs waiting for this chance. Once strong enough, this flock has moved to a new home. With the appropriate precautions, do any rising young star. Inside this compound at the San Diego Wild Animal Park, they try to recreate the condor habitat as closely as possible. And at first, that meant using a hand puppet to feed Fisquawk. Over the months, his progress exceeded anyone's dreams. And with his first flight in September of 1983, Fisquawk grew from a fragile survivor to a proud symbol of the country's untamed past.
People around the world are watching this program to see what's going to happen, and then they'll use it as a model for programs elsewhere. So I think the thing that motivates us is knowing, one, that we're going to get a tremendous amount of pleasure out of working with the birds, and then knowing that the things we do can serve as a model then around the world to help other birds makes it all very, very worthwhile.
The flight of the red-tailed hawk, coming up next on Those Incredible Animals.
This portion of Discovery is brought to you in part by Clorox Liquid Bleach.
Have you smelled Clorox bleach lately?
Smells like a cool, clean ocean breeze.
Fresh, fresh, so fresh.
Smells like the sunshine through the trees.
Fresh, fresh, so fresh.
Fresh scents, Clorox bleach.
Tonight's top story, storms on the East Coast causing delays up and down the entire eastern seaboard.
No, my plane's stuck somewhere back east.
Your flight has been canceled. The five most hated words of every business traveler. It's an absolutely guaranteed instant headache. You're just suddenly helpless. On a day like this, I know it's not the airline's fault, but that's not the point. I'm just looking for some answers. I want somebody to tell me my options. I just want somebody to tell me when I can get out of here.
Let's see if we can reroute you to another city.
Those are the people I come back to. They try and find a way and make it happen. They give me my best option, maybe even on another airline. I appreciate that, because you know, a little honesty goes a long way. Tell Billy to look for me at halftime. I'll be there.
Hello. This is soap scum, and it's very hard to get rid of. Or was, before Tilex Soap Scum Remover. Made specifically to dissolve scum on contact. Just spray it on and wipe it off. Tilex Soap Scum Remover.
Merry Christmas. Next, saving lowland gorillas on safari, followed by a flight of deer. Then meet a woman dedicated to reindeer. Is she the daughter of Santa Claus? Find out coming up only on the Discovery Channel.
This is Isabeau, named after the character Isabella from the movie Lady Hawk. She is 10 years old, is that correct, Lori?
That's right.
And she's a beauty. Is it true they're going to live twice as long in captivity than they would in the wild?
That's correct.
That does my heart such good, I can't tell you. Thank you so much for being here with us to share our look at the beautiful birds of prey. From Marine World, Africa, USA, in Vallejo, California, I'm Loretta Swit. See you next time on those incredible animals.
Loretta Swit's accommodations provided by the Campton Place Kempinski Hotel in San Francisco, part of a worldwide family of luxury hotels.
Discovery is brought to you in part by Clorox Liquid Bleach.
Have you smelled Clorox Bleach lately?
Smells like a lemon fresh from the tree.
Fresh, fresh, lemon fresh.
Smells like a clean, fresh lemon breeze.
Fresh, fresh, lemon fresh.
Lemon fresh Clorox Bleach.
Live from Orlando, Florida. Welcome to New Year's Eve.